So let's turn to Hebrews in chapter 12 and verse 26 onwards. His voice shook the earth in those days, that is speaking about the time when God carried the old covenant upon Sinai, the time of Moses. But now He has promised, saying that once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heaven. And this expression, yet once more, denotes the removing of those things which can be shaken as of created things, in order that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we receive a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. We are, it says here that we receive a kingdom that cannot be shaken. We are to be part of a kingdom that cannot be shaken by circumstances, or by bad news, or by the devil, or by temptation, or anything. That is God's will for us. But one of the things we learn from the Old Testament is that many times what God promised to the Israelites, they could not experience, they did not receive. Because either they did not respond in faith or in obedience to what God said, and so they missed out on what God had for them. So when you read a word like this, that it's God's will that we should be part of a kingdom which cannot be shaken, we need to ask ourselves whether our life's experience corresponds with that, or whether we are missing out on something that God has for us. The kingdom of God is found today in the church. Jesus once said that in Mark's gospel that there are some people who are standing here, Mark 9 verse 1, some of you standing here will not die. Do you see the kingdom of God come with power? Now, He really meant that, that there were some people standing right there when He spoke at that time who would not die till they saw the kingdom of God come with power. Now, we know that none of those people who are standing there are living today. So if this is referring to the kingdom of God, when Jesus is going to reign over the whole earth and He comes back from heaven, then it's not true. So what did He mean? There were people standing right there who would not die till they saw the kingdom of God come with power. So it was not obviously referring to the second coming, that the whole earth would be His kingdom. He was, the word power reveals to us that He was speaking about the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Because Jesus said that when the Holy Spirit came upon His disciples, they would receive power. So when you compare that verse with Acts chapter 2, we see that the kingdom of God coming with power is on the day of Pentecost. On that day, 120 people came together and became the first church on earth. They were 120 separate individuals, but the Spirit of God came upon them and filled them. It was like putting these 120 pieces of iron into a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire, and they came out as one piece. The fire melted them together into one piece. They became one. And that was the church. See, that type of unity is never possible in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, they were just a congregation of individuals who were not related to each other. One of the great prayers of Jesus, just before he went to the cross, was that his disciples would become one, just as he and the Father were one. And that's what happened on the day of Pentecost. And that is the kingdom of God. So, that is the purpose with which God has placed the church on earth in different places. And that day it was only in Jerusalem, but since then it has gone all over the world. So when we think of the kingdom of the church, it was God giving the world a demonstration of what that future kingdom will be like when he returns to the earth. In other words, people who come to your local church should be able to get a taste of what the kingdom of God will be like when it covers the whole earth. And that's a good question to ask ourselves. When people come to your church and become a part of it, do they get a taste of how it will be on earth when Jesus reigns over all the earth? If you are honest, in most churches it's not like that. There's a lot of strife and competition and jealousy and many, many things within the church that have got nothing to do with the kingdom of God. The values of God's kingdom are exactly the values that you find in heaven. The kingdom of God is called in Matthew the kingdom of heaven. Matthew always calls it the kingdom of heaven. And it's also called the kingdom of God in the other three gospels. So the kingdom of God is the kingdom of heaven. So if you want to know the atmosphere that should be found in the kingdom of God is the atmosphere of heaven. One of the purposes with which God sent the Holy Spirit to the earth is so that the atmosphere of heaven may come into our heart. It's really true when we sing that song, "Heaven came down and glory filled my soul." Do you know, my brothers and sisters, even if you're not experienced it, that God's will is that you should experience the atmosphere of heaven in your life, in your home, and in your church. That's the only thing that will prevent you from being shaken in the coming days. As we approach the end of time, Jesus said there are many terrible things that are going to happen in the world. Some of us may think that we have found a place of security. Which is the most secure place in the world? Many people left India and came to the United States, thinking, well, there's greater security there, there's more money to be earned here, a better standard of living. But if you look around and see the decline, the moral, spiritual decline that is taking place in this country, probably far worse than in any other country, you have to really fear what's going to happen to your children as they grow up in this land. If you do not establish them in a life that cannot be shaken, if you do not plant them in a kingdom that cannot be shaken, it's going to be pretty bad in the days to come. Jesus said in Luke chapter 21, referring to the last days, he said, verse 25, there will be signs of the sun and moon and dismay among the nations. And he goes on to say in verse 26, the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Just like we read in Hebrews 26, God will shake heaven and earth. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud of power and great glory. When these things begin to take place, he says, straighten up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. We're not supposed to be shaken when everything else shakes around us. Jesus once told a parable, and that's what I want to point to you now. We're thinking of a kingdom that cannot be shaken, a life that cannot be shaken, building a home, father, mother, and children that cannot be shaken, so those children can go out into the world into an unshakable life. living in church and cannot be shaken. Remember, Jesus said that I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The powers of darkness will not be able to shake the church. The church comprises of individuals, you and I. And it's only if you and I have an individual life that cannot be shaken, that our home cannot be shaken. If you have a father and mother in the home that have come to an unshakable life, that home will never be shaken. And you have homes like that together in a church, you'll have a church that cannot be shaken. So, it starts with the individual life. It starts with each single one of us. Homes comprise individuals. Many homes together form the church. So I want you to turn with me to Luke's Gospel, chapter 6, where Jesus, at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, he said this in verse 47, "Everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does that, I will show you what he's like." Now listen to this, someone who hears God's word and does that, he's like a man who built a house. Our life is like building a house. Every day we are using bricks and mortar to build a house. With our actions, our words, our thoughts, our attitudes, etc., we're building a house. And he said, this man dug deep and laid a foundation upon the rock. And when the flood rose, and the torrent burst against that house, it could not shake it. It was unshaken because it had been well built. It was built on the rock. So he's telling us how we can build a house that cannot be shaken, a kingdom that cannot be shaken. That refers to our personal life. Look at this house as your personal life. Look at this house as your family life. And look at this house as your church. But the one who has heard my word and not obeyed it is like a man who built his house on the ground without a foundation, and the torrent burst, and it was shaken, and then it collapsed. The ruin of that house was great. It began to shake, it was the first step, and then it collapsed. So in the trials of life, things come our way, and we find ourselves being shaken by fear, anxiety, or we fall into sin easily. These are indications that your house is not strongly founded on the rock. Those are little warnings to make us wake up, check up your foundations. That is not God's will for you to shake. Our life must be unshakable, because God has made us partakers of the kingdom that is unshakable. So what does it mean when it says here, these two types of people, one built a house that did not shake, another built a house that should collapse. When I read this first, I thought these two people built on two different areas where one was more solid ground and the other was sort of loose soil. But as I read more carefully, I found they built probably next door to each other. So it had nothing to do with the soil. The soil was the same. But the difference was this. The wise man says in verse 48, dug deep. He did not lay his foundation superficially on the sand. He went down through the sand till he hit rock. And then he laid his foundation. So Jesus was saying, if you hear my word, because both men heard the word, remember that. They both understood it. The only difference was one obeyed and one did not obey. Maybe both were excited by it. That didn't make a difference. You can hear God's word and get excited by it. You say, boy, that was a tremendous message. And you can still build on the same. see, our inner personality, this is the three minds, our mind, with which we hear and understand, and our feelings, or our emotions, and then the deepest part of our personality is our will. And that is what God wants us to yield to Him. So think of mind, emotion, and will. If you understand God's word in your mind, you're still on sand. If you're excited about it, your emotions are excited, you're still on sand. But it's only when God's word comes down to the level of your will, and you yield your will and say, I'm going to do that. I'm going to do what God's word says. That's the time your house begins, your foundation is laid on the rock. With many Christians, it's the mind and the emotions that are stirred. That's why he says in verse 46, why do you call me Lord, Lord? When a person calls Jesus Lord, it means his mind has understood who Jesus is, and he calls him Lord. When he calls him, verse 46, Lord, Lord, then he's excited. His emotions are also stirred. So his mind is stirred, understood the truth, his emotions are stirred, and he's still on the sand. You know, sometimes when we sing these hymns, we can be moved. I used to, in my younger days, feel very moved when I sang some emotional hymns. And, you know, we can think of that moment now as if we love Jesus a lot because we're stirred so much. But I found that when I went home during the week, my life was pretty much the same. Till I came again next Sunday and I'd be moved emotionally. That's why a lot of Christians look forward to Sunday. That's the time when they feel excited, they understand the truth. Mind is instructed and emotions are stirred. It's a good feeling. But you still haven't built on the rock. It's when we obey the things we hear that we build on the rock. Then we become part of that kingdom which cannot be shaken. And for many years in my Christian life, I never took that seriously. You know, we talk about Sunday Christians, and some of us may think we're not Sunday Christians. But if you're not obeying God's word, we are. Our praise and our thanking God and all that does not have much value before God if we're not obeying during the week. Somebody asked me once, Brother Zach, what's the difference between your church and other churches? I said, well, I'm not here to say we are better than anybody else, that I will never say, because God is the judge of all men and all churches. So I never compare my church with any other churches. If ever I say, Lord, I thank you, I'm not like other people, or my church is not like other churches, I become a Pharisee. That's what the Pharisees said, Lord, I thank you, I'm not like other people. So I'll never say that, that's for God to judge. But there are differences among churches. That's why some of us left some church and came to this one. That's why people left other churches and became the magic. What is the difference? They look for, they can come, we go to a church because we look for something. What are you looking for? So I told this brother that one difference I can say is that for many churches, Sunday is the most important day. But in our church, part of the day is Monday, and Tuesday, and Wednesday, and Thursday, and Friday, and Saturday. In other words, how you live through the week at home and in your place of work is what makes your praise, thanksgiving, and listening to the word meaningful on Sunday. Think of a person who's lived a very faithful life through the week. That means throughout the week he's obeyed. He's heard God's word, understood it, obeyed. He's always laying his foundation on the rock. Throughout the week, laying his foundation on the rock. not just reading the word. For example, it's a very good habit to begin the day by reading scripture. You know, people talk about quiet time. That's good. That's how I, the first 7 years of my life, I spent studying the scriptures thoroughly. It helped me to understand what scripture, what God wanted of me. But if I have a quiet time in the morning, even for half an hour, spend half an hour or 45 minutes with God's word, you know, read and meditated on it, and then during the day, I disobey that word. I get angry with my wife, or I'm anxious in some situation, or I cheat in my business, or I fight with somebody in my place of work, or I get upset and angry with something on the road when I'm driving, or somebody hurts me and I don't forgive him. What have I done? I've instructed my mind for 45 minutes with God's word during the day, during the morning quiet time, and disobeyed it in many ways during the day. My life is on sand because only my mind and my emotions were affected in the morning. And it didn't make any difference the way I did. It would have been far better if you had not read the Bible in the morning and obeyed God throughout the day. Definitely it's better. The best is, of course, if you read the Bible and obey God's word. But if you have a choice between the two, I say obedience is better. Now, you probably never heard any preacher tell you that. Most preachers will tell you you must read the Bible every morning. I say you must obey the Bible the whole day. That's what I do. And the whole purpose of reading the Bible in the morning is to obey it during the day. But if you read the Bible and you ignore the commands of the Bible during the day, you're just fooling yourself. That's why we can do that day after day after day after day and say, I have a quiet time and I think I'm very spiritual because I had a quiet time every day. I read the Bible, maybe you can say I read the Bible 10 times. I'll tell you honestly, I don't have a great desire to read through the Bible 50 times. I want the Bible to go through me once. More than me going through the Bible 50 times to only increase my knowledge. I want the whole Bible to go through me once. That means whatever God has commanded, I want to do it in my life. I don't want to be on sand, which is my mind and my emotions, understanding and stirred by God's word with no obedience. I want to say it, dear brothers. This is the reason why many Christians never seem to make a progress in their Christian life. They come to a certain level and they become stagnant. That means they've given up certain bad habits. They don't watch filthy movies now. They don't tell lies. And in a certain way, their external life is cleaned up. But their life is still on sin. Do you think the Pharisees had their life on sand or on the rock? What do you think? Definitely on sand. Jesus' life was on the rock when you compare the Pharisees with Jesus. But there were many things that they all worked in together. They and Jesus. The Pharisees read the word of God. Jesus read the word of God. The Pharisees studied the Bible. Jesus studied the Bible. The Pharisees prayed. Jesus prayed. The Pharisees fasted. The Pharisees even did missionary work. Jesus went around preaching as well. There were a lot of Samaritans. But there's one thing missing in the Pharisees. They did not have obedience in their inner life because mind and emotion, their will was untouched. That is the difference. Do you know that the Pharisees had some good qualities in them? They had many bad qualities. But they had at least two good qualities. I want to show them to you in Matthew 23. One of the good qualities that the Pharisees had, that Jesus himself gives a certificate, is this. Now, if Jesus gives a certificate to the Pharisees, you can be pretty sure that he's got some value. It's not like somebody else who would have a certificate. scribes and Pharisees sit on the chair of Moses, verse 2. And listen to this. Everything that they tell you to do, do. But don't look at it in their actions. So, what is significant there is? Do you think Jesus will ever tell you everything that the Roman Catholics tell you to do? Or everything that the Methodists can tell you to do, do? Or everything that CSI Church told you to do? Or everything that the Mormons tell you to do? Or everything that the Jehovah's Witnesses tell you to do? He won't. To which group will he say, this group, everything they tell you to do? That means it is a group that the doctrines are all correct. Otherwise, how could he say such a thing? So he has one good quality in Pharisee's hand. His doctrines are all correct. And there's another one, Matthew 23 and verse 25. What you scribes and Pharisees, you clean the outside of the cup, which means their outer life was clean. Is that a good thing? There are many Christians whose even their upper life is not clean. That means their external testimony itself is bad. They have a bad testimony in their office, they have a bad testimony in their business, they have a bad testimony in their neighborhood, and fighting people or quarreling people. Isn't it good to find a Christian whose external testimony is good? The outside of their cup is clean. That's a very good thing if Jesus can give you a certificate that your external life is good. And he gave it to the Pharisees. You clean the outside of the cup. So what are the two things that were good about the Pharisees? Their doctrine was absolutely correct. Their external life was very good. Now many of us, if you look at your life, these are the two things you are also glorying in. You glory in the fact that your doctrine is all correct, unlike other Christians who have got wrong doctrine. You glory in the fact that your external life is good, praise the Lord. The Pharisees also have. And you could be a Pharisee, even though you have these two qualities. What is it that the Pharisees did not have? An inner life. In other words, their mind, understanding of God's word is okay, their emotions, their feelings about God's word is okay. They didn't go deep in their inner life to obey. See, every building has got two parts. Foundation, superstructure. This building has got two parts. And the important part of this building is not the walls. This all may look nice, but if the foundation is not strong, it will collapse. If the walls don't look nice, the foundation is strong, it will remain. It's the hidden part that's most important in a building. That's what prevents it from being shaken. You know, you read of an earthquake in some places, and some buildings stand, and some buildings don't stand. What is it that makes the difference? It's not the size or the shape of the building, it's the foundation. Sometimes when there's a storm, you find some trees are uprooted and they fall on the road, and some trees remain. What is it that made the difference? It's not how big the tree was or how beautiful the tree was, it's the roots. So whether it's a foundation, whether it's a building or a tree, it's the part under the ground that determines the strength of a building or a tree. And your life and mine also has got two parts. One is above the surface, which other people can see. And one is beneath the surface, our hidden life, inner life, which other people can't see. And just like a building is, strength is in the hidden part, and a tree's strength is in the hidden part. I want to say to you something you must never forget. The strength of your life is in the hidden part, the part which nobody can see. You can give people a good impression, and yet you may not be on a good foundation. Your life will shake. Times of turmoil. That's why if some terrific calamity hits you and you get all anxious and worried and complain, it is God saying to you, my son, my daughter, your foundation is not strong. I want to make it strong. Then you need to examine your life and say, Lord, why am I shaking in the time of testing? When everything is calm and peaceful, I can think I'm a good Christian. But if in the time of testing, you know whether you're a good Christian or not, if you want to know whether this building has got a good foundation, you've got to send an earthquake to this place. When the other way comes, you really know which building is strong or not. When everything is smooth in our life, you don't even know whether our life has got a good foundation. That's why God allows storms to come into our life, to reveal to us, so that if we don't have a good foundation, we can wake up and do something about it and say, Lord, what is it in my life that needs to be more deeply founded? I told you that hidden part of us is more important than the outer part. And there are Christians who concentrate more on the outer. There are those who realize that the inner part is the most important. One of the great verses in the Old Testament. There are some wonderful verses in the Old Testament. One of them is this. In 1 Samuel 16, verse 7. The Lord said to Samuel, in the last part of that verse, 1 Samuel 16, 7. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. If you meditate on that one verse, and examine your life in the light of that one verse. He says, man looks at my outward appearance, and God looks at the heart. Then I ask myself, am I more concerned about the outward impression I'm making with my life, or am I more concerned about those hidden areas in my life beneath the surface, my thoughts, my attitudes, my motives, then I can know whether I live before God or before men. Man looks on the outward appearance, and when I live before men, I'm very concerned about my outward appearance, very concerned with my impression I made upon people must be good. People must think I'm a good Christian. A man who lives before God, I'm very honest, he's not bothered what people think about him, because people could misunderstand him. Remember, they so misunderstood Jesus that they called him Beelzebub, Prince of Devils. But that didn't disturb him. If their opinion was worth nothing. It was only the Father's opinion that mattered. The Father said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So these are examples to show us that when we care for the opinions of men, we are in danger. Because then we can be very careful to preserve our outward testimony so that we create a good impression. And a lot of Christians are like that. They're satisfied that men think that they are good, but they're very disturbed if somehow some bad opinion went about them somewhere. God will never allow us to be tested beyond our ability. That's a promise of God. So when something comes into our life that we think that's a really strong trial, we need to ask ourselves, is it something that God allowed to come into our life which is beyond what we can bear? No, because God's word is true. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 says, God is faithful. It's a great promise. It's the promise that has helped me through many, many years of my life to have absolute confidence as I look into the future. I don't know what is going to happen in the future, but I know one thing. God is faithful. He will never, never allow a trial or a temptation to come into my life of any kind from now until the end of my life which is too much for me to bear. Do you believe that? If you're a child of God, I hope you believe His promise in 1 Corinthians 10:13. It's not based on what you and I feel. It says it starts with the statement, God is faithful. God is faithful, who will never allow you to be tempted or tried or tested by any trial which is beyond what you are able to bear. Which means, if I believe that, I will never be shaken. Why does the trial shame me? I can't say, oh, that was too much for me to bear, that's why it shamed me. How can that be? God said He would never allow a trial to come to my life which can shake me. I believe that with all my heart. I don't know what trial is going to come into my life next week. I don't know what massive temptation Satan is going to send into my life next week. But I know one thing. If it's too much for me, God will stop it. He will not let it come. I believe that. When I look back over the past 55 years that I've been a believer, I've seen one thing. There are things that God sent into my life 5 years ago. Trials, temptations, which I would not have stood 15 years ago. That would be too much for me. But God didn't allow the devil to send it to me 15 years ago because I was not strong enough. Maybe the devil wanted to send it. God said, no, you're not going to send it into his life. But 5 years ago, God allowed the devil to send it. Because God says, now he's stronger. He's more founded on the rock. Now you get tested. So I thank God for the trials and temptations that come into my life because to me they're a test of whether I'm founded on the rock or not. Look at it like that. So that when you shake, by shake I mean you get anxious, you get worried, you get afraid, you get upset, you murmur, you complain, you're shaking. You're not supposed to shake, my brothers and sisters. That temptation could have been overcome because God tested you before He allowed it to come into your life to make sure you could bear it. But maybe there was some area in your life that was not healed. Maybe you were not humble enough to acknowledge your limitation and seek God for grace. And so you shook. And that's a warning for us. So that in the final shaking, you don't collapse completely. The little shakings that come in your life, if you take heed to it, you can be protected from greater shaking. You know, it's like when somebody has a little chest pain and he goes and checks his, with the doctor, and the doctor says, yes, your heart is being affected. So be careful, take these medicines, be careful to do whatever you need to do to keep your heart strong. It's a little warning. That little heart pain was a little warning to save you from death, from something more serious. So, people do a little surgery or something, or they take some medicine and make sure the arteries are clear, so the blood can flow properly in the heart in a good moment. Everybody knows the little warnings. You know, that little headache that indicates your blood pressure is going up, and you're going to check up and you say, hey, I didn't even know my blood pressure is going up. I can get a stroke one of these days. So you begin to take some medicine. In our physical life, you're always alert to these little warnings that come. If you ignore them, you can die much before your time. It's the same spiritually. When you find something comes into your life and shakes you, it's a little warning. Take heed to your life. You're not founded on the rock. There's some area in your life where you've understood the scripture. You're moved by the scripture. Your mind and emotions are okay, but your will is not being yielded. You're not obeyed God. Some area, you've not laid your foundation on the rock. And if you you seek God in that area, you can become strong. God doesn't want us to collapse. God wants us to be part of that kingdom which can never be shaken. And so the difference, as I said, between the wise man whose house could not be shaken and the foolish man whose house was shaken was basically only one thing. Obedience. He yielded his will. When we think of mind, emotion, and will, mind is understanding the truth. Emotion is being excited about the truth. Will is obeying the truth. Mind, if you only understand and get excited, you're not sad. When you dig deep and say, I'm going to obey this, then your house is built on the rock. Remember this, my dear brothers and sisters. Never forget it. If you understand the truth of God so well that you can even explain it to others, it does not mean that you're founded on the rock. If you're excited about the truth that you hear, it still doesn't mean that you're founded on the rock. A lot of people think that because they listen to a very powerful sermon or they listen to some preacher whose sermon is very challenging, and they say, hey, I'm excited to listen to that man's preaching. They think they are spiritual. It's not true. There's one passage in Scripture, you probably know it, but I can remind you of it again, Mark chapter 6. Sometimes we can hear powerful preaching and say, boy, I like to hear that. That doesn't mean you're spiritual. Even if somebody speaks to you and convicts you of your sin, and you say, I like to hear that, it doesn't mean you're spiritual. You may think you are. Listen to this. Here was some very powerful preaching that King Herod heard from John the Baptist. John the Baptist said in Mark chapter 6 and verse 18, John said to King Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. Now that is a very strong statement, convicting a king of his sin. You got no right to take your brother's wife. It's a sin. But you know, it says here in the last part of verse 20, that Herod enjoyed listening to John the Baptist. Isn't that interesting? You can enjoy listening to a convicting message, and yet you can be like Herod. Because it's very temporary. You say, wow, that was a powerful message, I enjoyed it. But two verses later, you read that when Salome, verse 22, the daughter of Herodias, came in with her half-naked body, dancing before Herod, he enjoyed that also. That's how some believers are. They can listen to a very powerful message on Sunday morning and really enjoy the message and watch a dirty movie on the same Sunday evening and enjoy that also. Just like Herod. They enjoy John the Baptist. You know, Herod didn't enjoy the preaching of the Pharisees. The Pharisees were horrible. But John the Baptist was a fiery preacher. And Herod enjoyed listening to him. And then he enjoyed watching this sensual dance. That is how to deceive one can be, that one can enjoy listening to a powerful preacher and think that we are spiritual. It is in the mind and the emotion. Heaven's will was not yielded. When you enjoy listening to a sermon, it only proves that your mind and your emotions are excited. Always evaluate yourself by, have I obeyed? Then you'll get it wrong. Look at the things you've heard in God's word and see how much you've obeyed them. Then you did wrong. So, Jesus emphasized obedience. Unfortunately, many people think obedience is an Old Testament word under the law. They they misunderstand grace to mean that, well, it doesn't matter now if you don't obey, because God's grace just forgives us. That's a complete misunderstanding of grace. The difference between law and grace is this. Under the law, there were commandments given to man. Man couldn't keep them. In grace, God helps us to keep them. Under the law, the commandments were only external. Under grace, God raised the standard and showed us what He really wanted. For example, let me show you a verse in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5. You see, it's at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount, by the way, is in Matthew 5, Matthew 6, and Matthew 7. That's the longest sermon of Jesus recorded in the Gospel. And at the end of the sermon, He said these words, which we just looked at. Those who listen to these words of mine, Matthew 7:24. These words means Matthew 5, Matthew 6, Matthew 7. Those who hear these words of mine and do them have got their foundation on a rock. They'll never shake. But those who hear these words, that means those who read Matthew 5, 6, and 7, and don't, that means they hear it, understand it, are excited about it, but don't obey them. They're foolish people. So the foolish man is one who reads the Bible. The foolish man is one who goes to church. The foolish man is one who attends the services on Sunday. The only thing is he doesn't obey. He shakes. And one day, another day of shaking, little shakings have come into life seriously. One day his whole house collapses. There are people whose lives have collapsed like that. There are families that have destroyed their homes like that, and there are churches that have been destroyed who did not take the little shaking seriously. So here's one thing that Jesus said in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. He says, if you speak angrily with your brother, Matthew 5, 22, and then you say something, you call him rabbi or you're a fool, you're in danger of going to hell. So after speaking angrily to somebody, if you spoke angrily to your brother or your wife or your husband or somebody, brother in the church, you got really lost your temper. And then you come to present your offering, verse 23, to God. And while you're praying, you remember that you spoke angrily to somebody. Jesus said you must leave your offering there. Stop praying. And go and first be reconciled to your brother. Go and ask forgiveness from your wife or husband or that person you hurt. And then come back and present your offering. Now, if you don't do that, you understood it, and it's so clear. If you don't do that, if you don't do exactly what Jesus said, that means when you come in prayer, you hurt somebody and you don't set it right before you pray. You're not building on the rock. You're building on sand. It's guaranteed that your house will collapse one day. Your life will collapse. Your family will collapse. So, we must seek to be a part of a church where we are constantly challenged to build our life on the rock. We must listen to preachers who always challenge us to obedience. Not those who just give us instruction, or those who just give us some emotional excitement through preaching. There are sermons that are preached in Christendom today which instruct you. Good. There are sermons that preach an extension, but it's still sand. You must listen to that and challenge it into obedience. Remember, mind and emotions are sand. It's when your will is yielded that God can establish your life on the rock. And it's so very important that we take this seriously, brothers and sisters, because as we approach the end of time, the only thing that will enable us to stand firm, be ready to meet the Lord when He comes, is if our life is established unshakable. We are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And we'll read that again in conclusion. In Hebrews chapter 12, it says, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, Hebrews 12:28, let us offer to God an acceptable service with reverence, for our God is a consuming fire. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear brothers and sisters, I want you to think about perhaps some area in your life where you're satisfied with understanding a scripture to not see you obey it. And you say, Lord, please help me to not deceive myself by understanding or by emotion. Be obedience to your word. Anything that you have spoken to me, show me if I am not obeying. Heavenly Father, you know we live in a world of deception. We want to escape that deception. Please help us to build our house, our home, our family, and our life on the rock of the life of shame. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.